back in alignment with your will over our life, that you ignite a fire in us, that you remind us of the you being present in the words you spoke over us when we were in our mother's womb, that we are to dominate the world rather than be dominated. Father, I ask that anything that's not in alignment with your will over our life, I ask that you come into our heart, that you seek out and destroy any arch the devil has placed in our soul. Father, I just thank you. You're the best daddy. I love you so much, Father. I ask that you dispatch angels of protection on all your children who are struggling. I ask that you dispatch angels of insight and wisdom on all your children that are prospering. I love you so much. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Yay. The paper one's for me?
You need it?
No, sir.
Okay.
Not this morning. Thank you, though, for being willing. Y'all gonna make me nervous, man. Go ahead and take a seat. Y'all are good. I'm hopping on me real quick.
Back to bundle.
Man. I had a fun time last night. I got those discussion posts when you're in school are supposed to be, like exhibition matches in boxing. You're there for the viewing pleasure and the sport itself, and no big deal. Last night I got dang on bombarded by like three different people. I posted three paragraphs, and apparently the whole state of Texas hates me right now. So, find out what's going on later. I don't know. I seem to always accidentally do something like that. So.
Bless your heart.
Yeah, I know. We're all right. I will, and I will, in all honesty. The problem is, I don't know if they will. People get incredibly worked up when you don't agree with exactly what they say in every facet. So much so to the point to where, there's no telling. Depending on how angry you get or how prone you are to staying angry, it might wreck your day, wreck your week, wreck your month. You know what I'm saying? People get bent out of some silly things. Silly things. All right, what's up? How's that book?
Yeah.
I skipped the night last night. Anybody got anything specific coming out of that? Y'all reading anything else on top of that? Or really anything else at all that you've kind of been able to piece together? Or make attach? Anybody anywhere?
Yes, I'm reading Max Lucado, He Chose the Nails.
Mm-hmm.
He also chose the spit.
Mm-hmm.
He also chose getting lashed. And he didn't wipe the spit off.
Right.
He went and he was like, I'm gonna sponge the spit of the world, the sin of the world, the nasty parts of the world. I'm not even gonna wipe it off. Because I love you that much.
It's pretty sad.
It is, man.
That's deep.
Jesus is cool, bro.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Really. You know what I'm saying? Like, in all honesty.
He's kind of my hero.
He really kind of is, to be totally serious.
Amen. For real. He saved the day, man. Saved my life.
I know. There's not a part of me that understands how people could, like, and you know it's because they don't really read it, and even on top of really reading it, like I talked about yesterday, they don't really understand it. There is so much just crazy, outlandish, fiction sounding stuff that goes on in the Bible that's like, it should be just an interesting, okay, what other kind of stories are you going to read where dude's sleeping in the middle of the night and the other buddy comes through and nails a railroad spike through his noggin and pins him to the floor in the Bible, right? All sorts of crazy stories like that, and there's some sad ones and some cool ones, but like, you get into reading that stuff, and it's weird. It's weird. We were talking about one the other day. Someone making promises that aren't good. There's a guy whose name I can't remember. I always forget. He makes a promise to the Lord. He's like, God, if you give me X, I'll sacrifice the first thing that comes walking out of my house. God gives him X, and the first thing that comes walking out of his house when he gets home is his oldest daughter. You only made a promise, bud. Stuck. Solomon tried to cut a baby in half. you know what I mean? Like, some crazy stories. Those two moms show up. Well, one mom is not actually a current mom. She steals this other mom's baby. The real mom takes her to Solomon. She's like, she stole my kid. She's like, no, it's my kid. And Solomon's like, I got a brilliant. I just cut it in half. Both y'all can have a piece of kid. Everything will be just fine. Both of you guys get what you want. The real mom's like, no. She can have the whole baby if you don't cut her in half. Yeah, and then the whole baby. Solomon's like, yeah, you're the mom. Arrest her. Give the baby back. Go home. It's crazy stuff going on in the Bible. Jesus is one of those ones that, look, he's about that. Nobody really understands. He really was about that life. He got people trying him left and right, and he'd just be like, why? You didn't know he's your man? Not only do I say I'm the Son of God, I forgive sin. Y'all better watch out, man. You got something else coming.
Everybody
that's what I imagine when, like, when Jesus and the disciples have an encounter. That's the music playing in the background.
Everybody be hating on
me.
Yeah.
I want to share something like quick.
Yeah,
man. There's another part of the book I'm reading. It talks about, of course, Jesus coming to bear the weight of the world's sin, but also coming to bring recognition of sin. Okay. And then it talked about when you go to plant a little oak tree, and you go ahead and plant it, and you leave, and you come back a year later, and you leave, and you come back a year later, and you leave, and you come back 5 years later, you see how this oak tree has grown to a magnificent big old tree, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you take a look at this deal, 2,020 years ago when Jesus showed up, and he brought the recognition of sin. Okay. Prior to that, there was all kind of crazy stuff going on. Even taking a view at the Roman Colosseum, beasts killing people, people killing people.
Yeah.
These folks even went off and got exotic women from other lands, brought them back and did some horrible things to them. Bam! Jesus shows up and brings the recognition of sin. Fast forward 2,020 years later. This recognition of sin has gone in the depths and rooted into our society such to the point as it's a sin to jaywalk across the street. In worldly eyes, it's a law. You can't cross the street without going to the crosswalk. Thank you, Jesus. So in this one, I find this very enlightening when people try, who's Jesus? I don't believe this stuff. Okay, well, the recognition of sin has gone into such
it's
depths.
It's everywhere else.
Yeah, I mean, there's been, you can't rape, you can't murder, you can't steal. And what's all this rooted in? The recognition of sin that Jesus Christ showed up and said, hey, y'all, I need to let you know what you're doing. So there's non-believers that are following all these recognitions of sin who will put a pistol on their hip and go and stop this stuff going on. That's a non-believer.
Right.
To say it's some of them are.
Well, that's full-blown evidence of like
Jesus Christ being the man.
Yeah, but I mean, that's you know, it pulls from the scripture. The word of God has been written on the hearts of men. So it's not necessarily something now that you've got to listen to and learn all of a sudden. You're made in the image of, we had a good conversation about this last night, me and Joe and Ryan did. You're made in the image of God, that means you possess the qualities and the characteristics of God. So now, innate within us, depending on whose jurisdiction we're living under, it only operates to certain degrees, but now innately within us, we crave righteousness. We crave justice. We crave mercy. Everything that is that forms the full being of who he is, we know in part, we prophesy in part, right? So we get in certain situations and we think that it'd be better to exercise judgment, so we exercise it. We think that it'd be better to exercise or receive mercy, so we exercise or we desire to receive mercy. You go through and you'll find yourself in different areas and stages of life where that scripture, more than just, oh yeah, okay, the word, like, you'll understand the more you compare yourself to the person God is, to the character that he possesses, that's shown to us through Jesus Christ. Nobody can escape that. Mankind as a whole is created in his image. Now, whether or not those characteristics are being properly functional in the kingdom of God is another story. Right, because there's plenty of people that operate outside that still operate according to the law of sowing and reaping, still operate according to the law of faith, that still operate according to the law of possessing and representing his character, just not to its fullness. Right? Because there are tons of people I know that are very just people, but without the Holy Spirit, it's not going to be kingdom justice to a T, or mercy of God to a T. They're merciful people, they're kind people, they're gentle people. But again, like we've been talking about with the three power types, my dunamis and my kratos is only going to get me so far. I can only be so kind, or so gentle, or so just, or so merciful before eventually there's going to be a part of me that my carnal nature is like, man, I'm capped out. I can't do it anymore. Right? That's why that's like the problem that I have with the this person is toxic cancel culture that's going on for like the last 5 years. you understand that that is the most anti-Jesus thing that we could be a part of, is just to drop people because they're bad for us? I'm not saying engage and flirt and mess around with what they got going on, but it is anti-gospel for you to say, I'm different than you, bye. The whole intention of Jesus was to take the difference, right? The word holy itself, the Hebrew word holy is the word kadesh. It literally means different, set apart, consecrated. It's to take that action and that attitude and invade every other portion of culture that you can find yourself in. We talked last night, the conversation we were having is that when you're, and I think we talked about this on a Monday, maybe a couple of months ago, when you're looking for the will of God in your life, and everybody's asking God, like, I want this direct thing. I want the thing that you want me to do for the rest of forever. And until we get that, we've got two options, right? We can sit around and twiddle our thumbs and wait for God to drop it in our lap. Or in the meantime, we can take the image-bearing ability that we have in Christ and put our hands to multiple things and reproduce the kingdom in every way possible until he gives us that initial directive.
I just looking to add this.
Yeah,
I'm going to be quiet for this.
No, you could.
This is a very tight line of you gotta be very careful with this, right? And I'm gonna give you an example. I didn't think of this. It's in the book I read. In God's will for us over our life, when I think I'm doing good, I've got to be very careful. Prime example: Jesus Christ's ministry was 3.5 years, right?
Okay.
It would have been great for him to go on and live until he was 90 years old,
sure,
raising the dead, opening blind eyes, healing the lame, healing the leper, opening deaf ears. Right? That would have been wonderful. He could have lived for 1,000,000,000 years in doing that.
Sure.
Right? Wouldn't that have been good?
Yeah.
Was it good? Was it in God's will for him to do that? No.
Right. He had a directive.
In my eyes, I'm thinking, man, it would have been great for him to be right here, right now, sitting here, healing my fungus that got on my foot. That'd be great. But it wasn't in God's will, man. So for me, in my eyes, when I think I'm doing something that's good, I think it's good, I gotta be very careful. Because if it's not in God's will, it's a sin.
Here's something to think about on that note. He is here right now. And that's why he left. So he could be everywhere at the same time. So you can get healing for that right now. And that is his will. So don't think that you have to suffer with that and not receive the healing because it's available.
And in other instances, you find things like, right, Jesus knew what he was doing when he came, right? There was an intended purpose, but that's the point that we're getting at yesterday. And we were talking about this last night in the classic church. Jesus would have done it would not have made sense for him to say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And then to have not done anything until the day he was crucified. Because then all that shows is that God is weak and able to be snatched up by men and put on a cross with no other outside ability to perform anything according to his character. So while Jesus knows, yes, you know, there's going to come the time where it's not my will but thy will, and I have to get up there and they're going to crucify me. In the meantime, what does he do? He's traveling, he's teaching, he's healing. He's teaching, he's traveling, he's teaching, everything that's coming out of him is coming from him being the express image of God, like we learned that in Colossians 1. So while he's out and about and around doing his thing, until that number one, right, this is here's my maximum, this is the climax of my life and my purpose in ministry, until that happens, he's not idle. He's not sitting around doing nothing. He's being proactive for the kingdom of God because he understands that if he's going to be the bearer of God's image the same way that we are the bearer of God's image, then we then take on a responsibility to act like God would act. Right. What do you look like? What part of me needs to look like you more? What can I engage in through faith that's going to develop my character into looking more and more like Christ? Right. Good. So now, we're on the faith block.
Have one comment.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we were talking about cutting off relationships.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a balance to that.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in a situation where you're being influenced by that person and you're not influencing them, then it might be a good idea.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I just want people to understand, because one of the number one things that I see going into jails is most of the people who go back,
mm-hmm,
it's because when they got out,
they went back to the same.
They went back to the same people. So, just, you know, just something to think about.
Yeah. Yeah. So okay. Good. So let's hit that because that is a good point. You don't want to. Okay. When we're talking about seeds, you're talking about planting, right? God, when God initially created everything, he put man in a garden. So God, he knows all about gardening. He knows about seeds. He knows about the time it takes to plant and that you have to wait for harvest. He's trying to teach us the same thing. When you get into those sort of things, if you look at yourself as a seed with the potential to blossom and grow and produce fruit, right? Because that's basically what all seeds do. You put them in the ground, you wait a little while, they spring up out of the ground, they produce a lot of the type of what they are. Right, that's why you get into like one can put 1,000 to flight, right? Two can put 10,000 to flight. Because when you produce, it always exponentially multiplies the thing that you're planting in the ground. Now, if you're wanting to produce certain kind of fruit or certain kind of anything, you've got to make sure the environment in which that thing is planted is healthy enough to foster that which you want to grow. Right, so if you get out and you want to come back and you're wanting to start producing fruit of the Holy Spirit, it is not going to do you any good to plant yourself in a place or in a group of people that is not under Holy Spirit's jurisdiction. Because all you're going to do is, all right, it's now you're dealing with, it's like Donnie calls it missionary dating. Now, you know that person ain't good for you. I'll change them. I'm going to get together, we're going to go to church twice, and everything's going to be just fine. Doesn't always work out like that. Friends work just about the same way. So yes, please be careful with what you got going on. But so the balance is, be wise. Don't allow yourself to be deceived or conned into getting back into something that you know is not good for you. But at the same time, don't dump the potential of the person that's not good for you just because they're not good in the moment. Remember them in prayer, right? Intercede for them. We do stuff like that all the time because we know you can't just go back out to the trap house and hang out with buddy because you're praying for them, but you can still pray for them.
And also with the balance, like just because someone's not good for you and you may not surround yourself with them, I heard something yesterday. Is it okay to cuss at somebody or to badmouth somebody or to treat somebody? Well, would you badmouth God? Would you cuss at God? You're created in God's image, so cussing at somebody or badmouthing somebody is like badmouthing God because we are in His image.
Right.
So just because it's not good to be around them doesn't mean you have to down them. You have
right.
to.
Right. Well, that's the deepest root of honor, is the ability to look at somebody for who you know they're supposed to be, even though they're not acting like that.
Right.
And that's how you get into proper position to be able to minister even more to that person. If in the meantime you can sit back and say, look, they're off in it. They're out doing the thing, buck wild, crazy, and all of that. But there are still portions of them when they're not off in it, acting buck wild, that display God's express image, even if they don't know it. Right, so your job then is to invest in those portions. Because the biggest problem that we have is trying to get people to say no to sin instead of just saying yes to God.
Amen.
If you would say yes harder than you said no, you wouldn't have to worry about saying no. Your yes would eliminate everything else instead of you having to sit, right, and be like, man, I wish I was no to this, no to that, no to this, no to that, no to this, no to that. If you just say yes to Jesus one good time, He'll take off with you, man. And you don't have to worry about saying no to everything else. It'll just fall by the wayside. Let's get into these notes for a little bit.
One
more thing.
Okay. For me, a couple years ago I started to scratch the surface. And as far as like cussing, I might cut, one might slip out every now and again, right? But I want to go deeper, man. I want to ask every single one of you, rather than the audible things that I can hear that you can hear, I want to yield my thoughts. I want to know, what am I thinking when I see this? I'm not going to cuss them. I'm not going to talk bad about them, but sometimes that little tiny sliver of judgment, little tiny sliver of thought comes in and says, I'm not a good person. No. Taking a view from the cross, I want to say, man, that's a wonderful, that's a champion of the world.
Right.
So I want to ask every single one, challenge you today. When you have that thought come in, bump what you say, the thought.
Right.
He knows then too, believe me. So let's try to curb, I'm going to try to. Let's make a deal with each other. Let's try to curb our thoughts today rather than what we say. Of course, we're going to work on that too, but dig deeper.
Love it.
Amen.
Dig deeper.
You have the ability, I think it might be a spiritual gift, to take any one-liner and turn it into a song.
Yeah.
A heavenly melody. That's exactly what it is. I love it.
It's a song in my heart.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Right on. Well, in light of that, again, because I love y'all, good morning.
Good morning.
How are we?
Good morning.
All right, let's hop back into these notes, man. We had an awesome time at class last night. The discussion was fantastic. Talks about God and how he works in our life. When you can be real and open and honest about it, are so edifying. They're so good for your spirit. So I would encourage, I mean, I know, you know, not to be cliquish, but find that group, find that wise counsel group that you can sit down with and just jot back and forth, learn from each other, sharpen each other, discern all sorts of crazy stuff. I'm telling you, some of the most intense revelation I've ever received is not because I was praying, but because I was talking to somebody, and then later on in prayer, Holy Spirit clicking that thing, and it was just a big boom. Right, in my brain and in my heart. So find those people, man. It's very important for your growth. We're going to get back into, let's get back, and we'll start at faith as a substance, hope as a goal setter, heading we were under yesterday. Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Now faith is, two words surrounding faith are now and is. Faith that is the substance of things hoped for is always now faith. If faith is not now faith, it is not faith at all. Hope is always in the future. So we talked about the relevance of those things towards each other. Hope is the thing that I'm envisioning and I want to happen. God, I hope my parents get saved this year. That is what I want to see. I hope my parents get saved. How am I going to get from where I'm at to experiencing the hope of my parents being saved is by having faith in the Lord. That is the tangible substance that I have. While I'm waiting, I know for a fact through other experiences that I've had, listening to the testimony of others, that there is something that I can hold on to while I'm waiting to get from this point to that point. Hope is the vision. It's what's going on ahead of me. It's the goal setter. Faith is what I'm clinging to right now. God has already done all he is going to do about healing. This is a good example. Deliverance and provision. We talked about deliverance and healing yesterday. God's will is found in his word, as we've taught multiple times. God's word is his will. If you are ever looking for what it is you are supposed to do in life, turn to the Word of God, and there is going to be something in there that quickens you in that moment, in that season, or in that lifetime that's going to put you on that track. Because if you're bored and you don't know what to do, and it's, God, I'm looking for what I'm supposed to do, what am I supposed to do? You're not talking to me, you're not telling me what I'm supposed to do, and I have no idea. Every last one of us, insofar as being believers in Jesus Christ, have the same baseline mission. It's to go and make disciples of the whole world, baptizing them in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If you start there, you cannot go wrong. And God will take that simple obedience and doing the small things, just discipling the people around you over and over and over again, and those things will develop. He'll narrow that. He'll give you a channel. He'll give you a niche. He'll give you a platform or a position or a sphere of influence or whatever you want to call it. And then slowly but surely, he'll start moving you into that exact one thing, and then everything you do from that place will be, you'll just feel peaceful, whole, clean, proper, like you're not wasting time. But until then, man, just do what you know God would have you to do and represent his character in the earth. Just bear his image. Bear his image. In the meantime, while you're waiting, bear his image. You see somebody that needs prayer? Man, you know how many times Jesus was on the way to do one thing and stopped off because he saw somebody else that needed prayer? My mom brought up a good point about that last night. We talked. He's on the way to heal Buddy's daughter. And the woman with the issue of blood pops up, and they're moving through a tough crowd. Dude's daughter's dying, and he's like, man, we got to hurry up and get here so Jesus can heal my daughter. And the lady's like, man, if I could just touch him, I'd be healed. So she does, and Jesus stops the whole parade. Who touched me? And the disciple's like, bro, you see how many people are in this crowd? Of course somebody touched you. And he's like, no, I felt something. Something left me. Somebody, like, touched me. Somebody touched me. Right?
That's
so
right.
He stops and he's trying to find out who touched me. In the meantime, Buddy's like, Jesus, my daughter's out here coughing up a storm, can't breathe, can we hurry this up? And he's like, yeah, hold on, who touched me? If you go throughout life so worried about trying to get from point A to point B, you'll miss. Remember in the alphabet, when you learn alphabet when you were a kid, and it's capital A, little a, capital B, little b? You trying to get from capital A to capital B, you'll miss little a. And little a is important because you need to know how that functions too.
Mm.
You understand what I'm saying? So you get both sides of the coin. Yes, the dude needs the daughter healed, but yes, 12 issues, probably got 12 years with an issue. And Jesus is like, no, hold on. Why? Because he understood why, yes, I have a main goal mission. I understand what I'm doing in that moment, right? The man's like, dude, my daughter's sick. He's like, hey, I got you. Let's go. He takes off. He does not neglect everything that goes on along the way to get there. Why? Because in order to represent God's image in the earth, it's not neglecting one person because he's no respecter of persons, right? He could have been official this, and now you know how that is. We tell this story all the time. People with issues of bleeding, they're kicked out of town, literally. They got their own, you know, lepers got their own leprosy camp. These kind of people got their own little camp going on. They are completely discarded. So we're there, and if we think the same way, we're like, man, you know, if I could pray for somebody that's really got some power and influence, maybe they'll owe me a favor, and I'll pray for them, and something good will happen, and they'll be like, man, I really owe you one. And you're like, no, no, it's fine, but 2 years from now, you know you plan on coming back and using that favor. And we'll skip over whoever's down here crawling around because they can't offer us anything.
Yeah.
We don't recognize them. We don't notice them. We don't take the time to stop when we feel them reaching out. However you want to implement that, man, it's incredibly relevant to our life to know that when you're going around to different places, your main goal in earth, right? God creates man in his image to take dominion, to be fruitful, to multiply, to reproduce of their own kind. It's the whole point now, if I'm a new creature in Christ, right, there's my identity. If I'm going to reproduce of my own kind, what am I reproducing? Other new creatures in Christ. That's my goal. That's my job. So you get in touch with all of that. God's word is the foundation of faith, and faith is the fuel of the authority of the believer. God's word is the foundation of faith, and faith is the fuel of the authority of the believer. I believe it's Psalm 119:89 that says, forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. That which has been spoken is finished, right? Not just Jesus saying it is finished, but think, when God created the earth, everything that he spoke into existence to this day is still running.
Settled.
One time.
By the word.
Let there be light, and there was light. Sun, moon, and stars, sun, moon, and stars, right? Land coming up out of the water, land's coming up out of the water. Vegetation is happening. Animals, still happening. Everything that he spoke into creation forever, forever, your word is settled in heaven. That should encourage us and warn us that the things that we speak have eternal value. Especially when you speak in the seated place of Christ. You got to be careful. Right. You have a responsibility. That's what we talked about. Beyond having a right to speak stuff in existence, you have a responsibility to speak stuff into existence. You've been made in his image. That's your job. God's word is the foundation of faith, and faith is the fuel of the authority of the believer. If you're going to walk in the authority of the believer, you are going to have to understand the foundation of faith and quit asking for things out of ignorance that are already provided. Right. We talked about that a little bit, maybe yesterday, the day before, where God give you more faith. To each man, he's given a measure of faith. Right. God, show me your glory. I'm seated in glory. You show my glory. Right. It is our job to represent that image. You have to get into the understanding. God, can you please, send the word of healing? That's not a bad prayer. It's not a wrong prayer. Right? We pray that all the time, and it works. We ask for that. God, send ministering angels, 100%. But if you're asking God, are you willing to send ministering angels to my sick and dying grandmother? Absolutely. And we know that because we know his character. So now instead of having to sit and ask for permission and wait to see whether or not he's going to say yes, you've been blessed with every spiritual blessing. Because why? Because you're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Right? So now you can say, right, by the authority that I've been given in Jesus Christ, send angels to minister, send angels to war, send angels to give messages. Those are things that you got in the bag right now. You're spouting it off left and right because you understand that the authority that he possesses is now the authority that you possess. And there's no point in sitting around and asking and waiting for something that you know is going to be there. Right? Why? Because he told you it's going to be there. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Right? But he did not tell them, so it's there. Are you ready to hear?
Yeah, so, I don't know. The more I read in this book, I guess it does. It's kind of shifted how I pray. Because I pray for it. But I've always been, I guess, timid on, like, you know, I don't ever want to tell God what to do.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So it's always asking. You know, it says ask, and I'll, you know, it'll be given to you and this and that. But like now, there's a shift happening because I am saying, like, hey, I need you to do that. I'm the Lord. I'm busy.
That's correct.
And I get it. He is. And if it's something that he's already given us, why not really exercise that? And, like,
that's right.
Walk in that.
That's right. And see, when you start thinking about things like that, it brings a whole new meaning to we come boldly before the throne, right?
Yeah.
It's my ability to not have to sit around and, like, walk up stammering, stuttering, and shaking all over the place. And, you know, do you think that you might maybe want to, if I've been good enough, be who you said you are maybe today? Maybe? Right? And he's like, yeah. So... You get into the understanding that you can come to, like, God, look, I can't do this by myself. This is what I need. Can you do this for me? Right. Not so much as in, like, God, you're going to do this, or I swear. Swear to what? Dang it. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's got you. He's going to take care of us. Okay. Me and my dad, we were talking about Jonah last night. Jonah's interesting, bro. Jonah's incredibly interesting. God's like, hey, Jonah, go to Nineveh. Jonah's like, no. I don't think I'm going to do that. You sure? He's like, yeah, I'm not going. Matter of fact, I'm going to go the total opposite direction of where he asked me to go. So, you know, he spends the three. Now, this is what's crazy. There's two theories to that. When he spends 3 days and three nights, there's a part in Jesus' ministry where he's like, he calls himself the son. Does it say the son of Jonah? I don't remember. He says, like Jonah, the son of man, will be in the belly of the earth for 3 days. Now, there's a bit that comes out of that where people are like, oh, well, that must mean since Jesus died and he was resurrected after 3 days, Jonah must have been dead in the belly of that fish. God resurrected him, spit him back out, and then sent him into them. That's possible. It's also possible that he was alive and it took 3 days for him to freaking change his mind because he was being too stubborn. Take whichever one you will, but here's the point. Dude got swallowed for 3 days,
yeah.
And then gets shot back out. Goes to Nineveh, and this is the interesting part. We do this sometimes, inadvertently and on purpose, but I think more on purpose. He's spit out on the beach. I'm thinking every time I think about this, I think about VeggieTales. He's spit out on the beach. And he's like, well, you know, I'll go to Nineveh, and here's why. Here's why I'll go. When you get into the end of Jonah, you see that he goes, he delivers the message, he leaves. Right, he doesn't stay around for the part where all the Ninevites go into a fast, including the animals. Right, they're like wrecked right now. God just sent somebody to speak to us and said we would be completely destroyed if we did not change it up. We got to do something to change it up. So they go into prayer and fasting. Jonah leaves, like goes, dumps the message, leaves, walks up on a hill, and is basically like sipping tea and eating popcorn, waiting on God to blow the place up. And then when it doesn't happen, it's like he's counting down 3, 2, 1. 3, 2, 1, and nothing's going on. And he's like, you mean to tell me that you sent me all the way out here to tell these people that you love them and you want them to change, and you meant it? So
yeah.
They changed, and now you're not going to destroy them? By God, you just utterly wasted my time, right?
Yeah.
There's a portion of us sometimes that when God tells us to do something, we say no, and then when we decide that we're going to do it, we're like, you know what, we'll do it because we know that the people we're speaking to aren't going to change anyway. Jonah was aware of how bad the Ninevites were, right? That's why they needed to change, period. They're like Vikings. They're just out doing whatever the heck they want to do. And he's like, yeah, you know what? They're not going to listen, so I'll go and do what you told me to because I know it's not going to matter. So we get out and we do stuff like that, and we don't couple it with the fact that God has already provided that thing which he said he's going to do. He gave them the opportunity, right? It's repentance or destruction. He's provided the avenue out of the consequence should you choose the avenue into him. Right? Repent. Or I'm blowing the place up. And they're like, okay, here, we'll have a council meeting. You turn around and you have a team huddle. And you're like, yeah, we'll repent. But there's a difference that shows, like, there's a legitimate godly sorrow apparent in the king of Nineveh and with the people. Like, there's something going on. God's already provided that thing, so when we go through and we're asking and translating into asking it for people's life, God, would you create a means for this person to come to know you? That's there, right? So you don't necessarily have to ask it thinking that it doesn't already exist. It would be better to ask God, how can I properly operate according to the avenue of salvation that you provided? What role do I play in this? what can I do for you, for this person, to lead them to you? And that always boils back to what we've been talking about all morning. Represent his image in the earth. Look like how he looks. The more and the more, that's what me and Bobby were talking about the other day, the more that you can just do what you know to do because you love God and it's what he's asked you to do. It's not, so you spend a lot less time trying to convince people with your words, and it's coupled with the representation of who Jesus is in your life, right? Everybody here knows that. You can go to church 15 times a week and get preached at for 3 hours a time, and it's not going to do as much good if you know for a fact that the person giving you that word is not bearing any of that fruit, is not operating according to any of that power, and is not living any of that lifestyle. The people that I look up to the most, I look up to the most because when they're teaching, I have already seen the fruit of what they're teaching me in their life. Right? So when we're walking around asking God, look, you know what? I need this, I need that, I need this, I need that. What am I doing? Am I asking from a place of, God, I know that you've got it. I know that you possess all things in the earth, and that's why I'm asking? Or am I asking because I don't think that way has already been provided? Does that make sense? Y'all ever been there before? Where you ask and you're asking because you're not sure if Jesus wants to do it?
What you're talking about, what you're talking about right now is just the position of our heart. Like,
yeah.
You know, sometimes I feel like I'm asking him something just because I know here that the word says I could ask that.
Sure.
That I've seen him do it, I've read it, but I haven't quite acquired the faith in my spirit to exercise authority over that. But I'm just asking it almost like superficially, and sometimes he, for his word's sake, for his name's sake, you know, he does it. I see him do it.
Right.
You know, but definitely would love to have it in my belly and just move in authority.
Mm-hmm.
And because there's a lot of things that I'm seeing through this class that you don't even need to ask him. You could just exercise.
Right.
Because he already did it.
Right.
He said, healing's already done. Deliverance is already done. All that stuff is already
right.
done. Everything that he was ever going to do is...
Right. Well, so we talk about, right, like the atonement for healing comes through what? Because of what? What action that Jesus participated in gives us access to healing?
A stripe. It's flogging.
Right. Okay. So when we're asking for healing, we're not... You have to understand that you don't have to ask from the position like you've got to beg him to come down and get beat all over again.
Yeah.
He took it and he sat down and said,
"Bleed your blood.
Now do something about it." When you're praying, pray from the knowledge that every stripe he took was for your healing, right? He was bruised for our transgression. That's the whole point. You can attach yourself to that word because he did it and said it is finished. Now it's yours to exercise. It's yours to exercise without having to beg for it because he did it and then told you he did it, right? He solidified that for you to be able to operate in. So yes, you know, God, we thank you for the fact that what you did positions us to receive the healing that you paid for. In Jesus' name, let this person be healed. Because he's not coming back to get beat up all over again, right? There's no need for him to get whooped. There's no need for him to get crucified. We don't have to go through that whole thing again. He did it one time for every person, and now we have the ability to exercise the and I don't say consequence like it's bad, the benefits of that action that he participated in. Does that make sense? You good? Okay. Let's work one more section because it'll be really fast. The law of faith. Faith is a law. Faith is the new law of God and the new covenant. Romans 3:27. Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith. In the Old Testament, it's the law of works that justified people or condemned people. But faith is the law of the new covenant. Romans 3:31. Do we make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. The same way that Jesus said, right? You've heard it said, don't do X, don't do Y. But I say, if you've already done this or that, you know, you've already committed it. Now, how do I know for a fact that there's something beneficial on the other side of not even thinking those things that would lead to that action? If I'm putting my faith in it, now, this is big things, right? We want to do, like, the big motivational thing. Like the whole phrase was like, I don't know, the haters are my motivators type attitude, right? Like to all the people that said I can't, I hope you see me now. I'm like, okay, good. Because, you know, and whatever, especially if we're saved and we have that understanding, you know, vengeance belongs to the Lord, says the word, and we're like, okay, well then exactly how much vengeance can I get before I cross a boundary? Because now, if you've told me I can't, and I did, now what I can do, the only form of vengeance I can exact is to show off and gloat about it.
Right.
Right? But what does that word say? Where is boasting? It's excluded. It's excluded. By what law? By the law of works? Mm-mm. By the law of faith. Regardless of what person said to me that I could or couldn't do, or regardless of what teacher told me I would or wouldn't ever be anything, or what parent left because they said I wasn't worth anything, or whatever you get into, you can sit and base your entire life on doing to prove those people wrong and try to exact as much vengeance as you feel like you have the potential to do, or you can operate according to the fact that God's got you, period, and everything that you get is a benefit to you because it's a benefit to His kingdom. That's what He wants from you. We'll stop this next piece, showing us that just as the works of the old covenant made you right with God, so now it is by faith that you are made right with God. And if your faith is not growing, you're in danger of losing salvation. That last little bit is important because what happens is if you are not solidified, we talk about faith being a firm persuasion, right? It's a firm conviction. When we're talking about losing salvation, we're not talking about losing the chance. We're not talking about God, you know, dropping you off and saying, never mind, I changed my mind. It's the potential that if you don't continue to operate according to the firm persuasion that He is who He says He is, and that salvation begins to flicker in your brain. That's why when you get the armor of God, it's the helmet of salvation, because it's intended to protect your mind, because that's where most of your attacks stem from, right? The enemy's going to jump in your brain and try to convince you that you are not who God says you are, that you don't have the potential that God said you had the potential for, that you're not in the same ownership of everybody else, right? I'm a Christian. He's my brother. We all say we're seated in Christ, but I don't see myself operating to the same amount of fruit that He's operating in. Is this whole thing even real? You now are juggling the fact in your own brain, which then translates into your own spirit, whether or not you're actually saved. Right? And we'll dump that thing off and be like, man, I guess it wasn't real, and drop it and take off and run in the opposite direction because we feel like nothing's happening for us. You've got to maintain the fact that faith now is the law that we operate according to. It's not about your works anymore. And that's where that whole thing comes in. When you start thinking about, man, I don't know if I'm doing enough, you're reverting back to the function of old covenant law, the law of works. We're operating according to a new law which says what? My persuasion is settled in Jesus Christ. What He said He was going to do, He's going to do. What He said He was going to sustain, He's going to sustain. Forever, O Lord, Your word is settled in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
We'll stop there.
That's a very controversial spot to leave us on, too, by the way.
Say again?
That's a very controversial spot to leave us on. You're in danger of losing your salvation.
Yeah, well, that's
all denominations have been.
So that's what I wanted to clarify. It's not the fact that God's going to snatch it away from you. It's the fact that, like, when you get in there and you start thinking, oh my God, am I actually saved? Because there's a scripture that I have that I
highlighted. You don't have to get into it. We just wanted to point out.
No, I'm
going to
type it out so that we can touch back on it.
But the whole language of the book of Hebrews is consistent with that. Like,
right.
Hold fast your confidence of faith. Hold fast your confession to the end. I mean, it's all through the whole book of Hebrews. Paul is talking to a group of people who accepted Christ as Savior, but now because of a little trial and tribulation have decided to denounce Christ and go back to Judaism.
Right.
So, I mean, it is, it's a real thing.
I got to type it out.
It's a real thing.
Because I need to do that this morning. Amen. Does anybody have any questions, comments, prayer requests about this morning?
Yes, I have a prayer request.
Sure.
You know, I go to a program that we that's AA-based.
It's already happened.
But I have church here in the morning that's explosive in a positive direction. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of caught in between because the one here says anything and everything is possible. Then when I go to over there, and he even says, you're always going to be a pickle.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, I'm one of those.